Hello friends, in today's episode I will be taking the top 6 Pokemon from the online rank doubles ladder. You should start creating a team with these Pokemon and throwing them together to see if they will work. Now you might think, of course it will work. Throwing the best Pokemon together and putting them in one team will just create, obviously, the best team possible. But as you know, if you play competitive Pokemon, there is way more than just using the best Pokemon that goes into building a great Pokemon team.
Hey bro, how's it going? How long have you been at this for?
Oh hey, I've been going about 18 hours.
Mm-hmm.
I've got 252 HP. And then I've got enough for speed investment, which allows me to outspeed that threat. And it's finished. Cover everything. I've done it. 300 matches later, 18 hours. Done all my calculations. This team is unstoppable.
What about that Pokemon?
Huh?
There is synergy, strategy, speed control, and many other aspects that you need to consider to try and squeeze into these 6 little monsters. You need to do damage calculations, have multiple lead combinations, and not to mention flowcharts, and spend every waking moment on Showdown testing against the most random stuff. So surely you can't just throw a bunch of Pokemon together without surely a thorough and thought out process, or can you? So how is this going to work? I'm going to be using Pikalytics, by the way, a great resource for anyone wanting to get more involved with competitive Pokemon. I'm going to take the top 6 Pokemon from the Pokemon Online Ranked Doubles ladder, throw them together and see if doing this can actually work to create a successful team. I'll be using each Pokemon's most common items, movesets, natures and spreads. Oh, and by the way, if any item is already in use from a previously picked Pokemon, we will move to the next most used item in that Pokemon's list, and we will be going through each Pokemon in chronological order from 1 to 6. So first, like I say, we head over to Pikalytics and check the Battle Stadium Series 7 ladder usage stats. I can take the 6 first Pokemon from the usage stats and throw them into a team. You can see we have number 1 is Tapu Fini with a moveset of Protect, Calm Mind, Muddy Water and Moonblast. They're the most common moves used, holding a Citrus Berry most common item, and with the most popular nature being a Modest nature. So Tapu Fini check. Second, we have Landorus, Therian Form, moveset Earthquake, Rock Slide, U-Turn and Fly. They're the most common moves used on Landorus Therian, holding an Assault Vest and an Adamant nature. Check. Up next, in third place, we have Regieleki with a moveset of Electroweb, Volt Switch, Thunderbolt, and Protect, and its most common item being Choice Specs. Wait, so its most used item is Choice Specs, and its fourth move is Protect. Okay, I'm making an exception right here. I refuse to run Protect on a choice item Pokemon. The next most used move is Light Screen. Not ideal, but a little better. So Regieleki, check. The fourth most used Pokemon is Metagross with a moveset of Protect, Iron Head, Ice Punch, and Stomping Tantrum, holding a weakness policy and an adamant nature. Check. Fifth, we have Cresselia with the moveset Trick Room, Ally Switch, Helping Hand, and Icy Wind with a bold nature and holding a Mental Herb. Okay, so just backtrack here. I searched everywhere in my game. I couldn't find a Mental Herb, so we'll go with the next most used item, which was a Citrus Berry. But then I realized this is the item that Tapu Fini is holding, and because of this item clause that we have in VGC, we can't use more than one item on the same team. So we'll have to move down the list again and settle on a Colba Berry, which I do have. So Cresselia, check. Now moving on to the final slot is Urshifu, number 6 in the usage stats, with a moveset of Wicked Blow, Close Combat, Sucker Punch and Poison Jab, holding a Choice Band most popular item, with the most popular nature being Jolly. So there we go, check. There we have it, the team is ready, and we've taken top 6 Pokemon used Pokemon from the ranked doubles ladder. We've got them in game. And now it's time to jump on the online ladder and find some opponents to see how well this team actually works. Our first opponent is against a player called Kai, playing a team of Metagross, Landorus, Tornadus, Cresselia, Tapu Fini, and Tapu Koko. There are a lot of threats in this team. The Prankster Tailwind from the Tornadus can be very problematic, especially if we see Taunt from the Tornadus to shut down a potential Trick Room options on Cresselia. Metagross is also a big issue with potentially weakness policy there, as well as the two Tapus and two Flying types, which make it a little tricky to bring Urshifu, who would be pretty good against the two Psychic types on my opponent's team. I decide that Fini and Tornadus are things I need to cover, and some sort of speed control will be important, so I lead with Cresselia and Regieleki in this one. Intimidate and a ground type to hit Koko and Metagross are going to be important, so Landorus is coming in the back, and I run the team off with Urshifu, hoping that I've got enough in Regieleki and Landorus and Cresselia to deal with the threats that are going to cause Urshifu so many issues. Honestly, at this point in team preview, the team already feels like it has plenty of options to cover a bunch of big threats and different teams, even though we literally just threw it together. So we get into the match and find my opponent leads with the Tornadus and Landorus. We lead with Cresselia and Regieleki. Now, I don't want to get nailed with a Protect potentially on the Tornadus and then an Earthquake from the Landorus, so decide to hard switch Regieleki to my own Landorus and go for an Icy Wind to prevent wasting a turn if I'm taunted to counterplay a potential Trick Room from ourselves. We do see the Tornadus go for a Taunt into the Cresselia, stopping potentially that Trick Room we're talking about, but because we're going for our Icy Wind, that's fine. The Landorus on the opposing side of the field goes for an Earthquake. We avoid that damage with a Flying and Levitate Pokemon on our side and get an Icy Wind off, reducing the speed stat of both Pokemon on my opponent's side by one stage. This is then followed up with a Tailwind from the Tornadus to get that speed advantage back on my opponent's end of the field and a U-turn from the opposing Landorus. But because of that Intimidate, we're not taking too much damage with our Cresselia as we see the Landorus switch out and the Metagross take its place. Now we go for a U-turn ourselves just to preserve our Intimidate and give us a nice switch in if there are any ground threats coming out from my opponent in future. And we switch into Urshifu. It's a nice opportunity for us to get Urshifu on the field and start pressuring this Metagross. We have to be a bit mindful that the Tornadus is on the field right now and it still poses a threat to Urshifu with those flying type threats, but it is back to neutral speed after we reset the Tailwind on the Tornadus, although we do not reset it on the Metagross due to the clear body. Now with Cresselia, we are taunted. We can't go any for any supporting moves here, so we just go for another Icy Wind. It's going to chip down that Tornadus a little bit more, and we actually decide to go for the Gigantamax on our Urshifu just to make sure that we can take attacks from the potential Tornadus and Metagross here. If the Tornadus decides to go for Brutal Swing, it will go after the Metagross this turn, proccing the Weakness Poncy after it's attacked, so meaning we will only need to take at least one attack from the Metagross before it is boosted up. And we can see my opponent's Metagross also going for the Dynamax here, so we are definitely in a awkward position right now, not able to gain any speed control because of that clear body. But with Urshifu on our side of the field and its Gigantamax, not something we normally would Gigantamax, but I think this opportunity kind of feels like it's a good moment for us to maybe go for a change here with Urshifu and go for that Gigantamax ability while we've still got the opportunity. We see the Steel Spike come out from the Metagross here, does boost the defense on the Metagross and that Tornadus, and the Tornadus actually going for an Air Slash, but we get quite fortunate as Urshifu avoids that and we do the signature G-Max One Blow move into Metagross, which does do nice damage to the Metagross and at the same time proccing a Weakness Policy. But with this in mind, we feel like we might be in a little bit of an awkward position, but after this turn, our Taunt should wear off with Cresselia, and we can always rely on our cheeky little ally switch here to give Urshifu a little bit of room to get another attack off into the Metagross, which could be enough to kind of clinch this match for us. Now, Cresselia getting that third Icy Wind onto the Tornadus will mean that we will have the priority here over the Tornadus, meaning we should go before it is able to get a Taunt off into us, and then Urshifu will be able to avoid a plus two attack from the Metagross and return with another G-Max One Blow to potentially pick up a knockout here. As we see the Metagross go for the Steel Spike again, it does knock out the Cresselia at the plus two, so Cresselia going down, but the ally switch proving more than beneficial here, allowing Urshifu this attack here as we see the taunt come off from the Tornadus into the Urshifu, which isn't going to affect us because of the dark typing, and we are able to get another G-Max One Blow off into the Metagross. This time, even with the defense boosts, we are able to take it out with that critical hit there. So taking the Metagross down, Urshifu doing its job, and my opponent now in a little bit of an awkward position, losing their Dynamax a turn early, especially after the weakness policy is procced, and we're sitting in a decent position, about to bring Regieleki onto the field as we see the introduction of Tapu Fini. This is my final G-Max turn with Urshifu, so I'm going to go for the Max Ooze attack into the Tapu Fini, just to get a special attack boost onto the Regieleki, which will help us out potentially the next turn, and go for an Electro Web, which should do good damage to the Tapu Fini and take the Tornadus down. But we do see my opponent actually withdraw the Tornadus here as the Landorus comes out onto the field. It is going to get an Intimidate, all important Intimidate, onto our Urshifu, which is going to reduce its attack stat. And we are in a little bit of an awkward position against this Tapu Fini that can hit us with some big fairy type attacks, but at the same time weak to the Regieleki. We just see the Tapu Fini protect here as the Landorus comes in and is able to be immune to the Electro Web. Now we do get the G-Max Ooze into the Tapu Fini, which is very beneficial for us here, and my opponent's Tailwind does come to an end this turn, meaning that Urshifu and Regieleki are going to be the fastest things on the field. We are going to be able to just go for a Wicked Blow into the Landorus here. I know that I'm going to be able to get this off before the Landorus attacks, and also that Tapu Fini, where if it does attack, it's going to go into the Urshifu and probably take us down there. The one thing that I need to do, if I can remove the Landorus from the field right now, we need to preserve Regieleki, because then it can come in the next turn once the Landorus is off the field, once that threat is removed, and deal with both Tornadus and Tapu Fini quite easily. So what I'm going to do is switch into Landorus here just to take up and soak up some damage from my opponent's Pokemon. And we'll go for that Wicked Blow with our Urshifu into the Landorus here. As you can see, we do outspeed the Landorus like we suspected and get that knockout with the critical hit Wicked Blow, taking the Landorus down, meaning that Regieleki, safe and sound in the back, can come in if anything does go down here and deal with the Tornadus and Tapu Fini quite easily. We do take a Muddy Water, no Moonblast coming out from the Tapu Fini there, but we do get an accuracy drop on both Pokemon, which is a little bit unfortunate. Now, the Muddy Water is potentially going to pick up the knockout onto Landorus and definitely the Urshifu the next turn, and we still have to contend with Tailwind, which is going to be a little bit of a problem for us going forward. Now, Regieleki will still probably outspeed Tapu Fini once it comes in, even with the Tailwind in effect, so we shouldn't be in too bad a position even with the end game here. But I'm going to see if we can go for a Rock Slide with Landorus here. We do see the Tailwind from the Tornadus. It does double the speed of my opponent's Pokemon, and the Muddy Water comes out, and Landorus, we get a little bit of fortunate again here as the Muddy Water does miss our Landorus and does take down Urshifu, but this means that Landorus is going to get the Rock Slide off into the Tornadus, take it down, and remove that from the field, meaning there's only Tapu Fini to deal with. And with Regieleki coming onto the field this next turn, we are going to be able to close this matchup pretty easily. So you see Regieleki coming out, and going to be enough to outspeed. So we go for that Thunderbolt into the Tapu Fini. Like I say, we should outspeed it even in the Tailwind, which we do. And the Thunderbolt with the Choice Specs is going to be more than enough to pick up the knockout onto Tapu Fini. There were a couple of occasions there where we got pretty fortunate, but all in all, I think we came out on the better side of this one and probably would have even without the luck that we got. So locking up the first one, very good game to my opponent. We jump into our second game. This time we're going up against a trainer called Dina, and they are playing a team of Urshifu, Regieleki, Tapu Fini, Glastrier, Dusclops, and Incineroar. Obviously, we've got the Trick Room threat of Dusclops and Glastrier, a very potent pair in the current format, and something that can be very dangerous if the Trick Room does get set up. So we need to try and mitigate that if possible, and just have ways if it does get set up to play around and stall the Trick Room out. That's going to be the biggest key for us. I feel like Urshifu is going to be a very useful Pokemon here. here, especially against the Dusclops, the Incineroar, the Glastrier. It can hit all of those Pokemon for very good damage, and especially with the Choice Band kind of boosting those attacks, it makes dealing with some of these Pokemon a little bit easier. So Urshifu, definitely something that we want to bring. I think Landorus as well is also going to be very useful. The Intimidate for that Glastrier, the Stab ground attacks for the Regieleki, and the immunity to Regieleki being such a fast offensive Pokemon are going to be very useful in this match in general. So going with the lead of Urshifu and Landorus, then we got to think what we want in the back. Now Metagross feels like it could be a very good component here. I do think about Cresselia. Do we bring it just to have the ability to reverse a Trick Room if it goes up? But I think figuring out that the Tapu Fini again could be quite a bit of an issue, might be worth bringing something like Regieleki. So we've got a very fast offensive Pokemon on our side of the field, and then rounding off with Metagross, who could be potentially our max Pokemon in this game. So Dina leading off with the Dusclops and Incineroar, and we lead out with our Landorus and our Urshifu. Now my opponent's in a situation here where they probably want to go for a fake out into the Urshifu. If they don't fake out that slot, then they will lose their Dusclops. A Wicked Blow boosted by the Choice Band is going to be more than enough, and they are aware of our items due to that Frisk ability on the Dusclops. First turn, I'm not making any weird or outrageous plays. We just want to go for the Wicked Blow into the Dusclops. If my opponent makes a mistake, we'll be able to punish them for that and go for a U-turn with our Landorus into the Incineroar. Just get some chip damage onto that Pokemon and help us readjust our board by bringing in Metagross in place of the Landorus. Now we do see the Dusclops go for the Trick Room, so the Trick Room count starts from this turn, but my opponent right now doesn't have the best offensive pressure on the field. We can take a turn with Metagross just to protect, stall a turn of Trick Room out if we want, and go for that Wicked Blow into the Dusclops and remove it from the field. That's the biggest thing. You know, the Incineroar has got the Intimidate onto us, and it could potentially go for a Parting Shot, but because of that critical hit rate that we've got with the Wicked Blow, it's going to nullify any of those stat reductions that we've taken up to this point. So we do protect with Metagross, just fearing a potential Flare Blitz here from the Incineroar. We don't want to take any unnecessary damage here, as we see a Nightshade come out from the Dusclops and a Parting Shot also into the Urshifu, reducing that attack stat. So that's something that my opponent is trying to do, weaken the Urshifu, but at the same time, like we've just mentioned, the Wicked Blow critical hit will just nullify any stat drops that we've taken. So Glastrier making its way onto the field in its perfect Trick Room environment for the Incineroar, and we do manage to get a Wicked Blow off with our Urshifu, which helps us remove the Dusclops and that potential setup from the Dusclops to the Glastrier with the weakness policy there, potentially seeing something like Rock Throw or Brick Break to proc the weakness policy. So removing that from the field is the first step in this game. Obviously we just protect with Metagross, so we're not going to be able to protect this next turn, but we can max if we want to, and I think a good plan for us now is to max Metagross, get Urshifu off the field, maybe try and get Landorus in its place, get an Intimidate onto that Glastrier, and start to kind of slow it down. Also, if we can remove the Tapu Fini from the field, it means that Urshifu can come back in late game and have a little bit of an easier time. With the Tapu Fini present on the field, it makes things a little bit more difficult for us, and we kind of at this point probably prefer to preserve Regieleki, and if we're sacrificing anything, it would be the Landorus at this point. So you can see the turn unfolds with us switching out our Urshifu into the Landorus. Like we mentioned, we want to get the Intimidate onto that Glastrier just to slow it down a little bit. It's such a powerhouse. And the other thing to mention here is it could be so easy for us to go after the Glastrier with our Metagross, but the one thing that we don't want to do is proc a weakness policy, so just targeting the Pokemon next to it, something like the Tapu Fini here, is the way better option. While we can go for the Steel Spike into the Fini, we can also boost our defenses to take the attacks a little bit better from this Glastrier if it starts getting those chilling nair boosts after this turn. So we see the Glastrier go for its Dynamax, and we're going to match that with our Metagross. My opponent making a really good read here with the Max Hailstorm, just probably predicting in case the Landorus does come onto the field and hitting us with a huge super effective attack, which does take our Landorus down and kind of just reverses the effect of the Intimidate here, as we see a Chilling Nair activate on this Glastrier. Now we get some really good information here. We are in a Trick Room, and our Metagross underspeeds the Tapu Fini, which is huge for us. We do just over 50% damage to the Tapu Fini with our max steel spike. Metagross still in a great position here, full health, got a plus one defense stat, and we see the Tapu Fini go for a calm mind, so it's boosting that special attack and special defense, but not something that we're too concerned about right now, as we are hitting on the physical side more than anything else. So we switch in Regieleki in place of the Landorus. I feel like if we can remove the Tapu Fini from the field on this turn with our Metagross, then Urshifu is a way more important Pokemon for us in the later stages of this game, as long as we can remove the Tapu Fini. Our reliance on Regieleki, which has predominantly come to deal with the Tapu Fini, isn't as necessary here. So we can kind of sacrifice that to see out the last few turns of this Trick Room. Now, one of the things I'm going to do here is go for the Max Steel Spike into the Tapu Fini once again, but we actually see the Glastrier take its turn to attack into the Metagross now. Now, we are going to take this pretty comfortably because the Glastrier hasn't got its weakness policy boost already, so it is boosting that special defense on it and the Tapu Fini even further, but it does in turn proc our weakness policy and mean that we are going to be guaranteed to take out this Tapu Fini, knowing that we're slower than in the Trick Room. We can take advantage of these speed conditions and remove it before it does anything or becomes a big threat to us, and also at the same time it means that Regieleki is in a nice position to get some good damage onto this Glastrier as well, unchecked, untouched, and it helps us stall out this Trick Room to no end. So we do get a Thunderbolt into the Glastrier, do some huge damage to it and put it into knockout range for one of the following turns, and my opponent coming down to just their Incineroar and Glastrier. Now, do you see the Incineroar hit the field for my opponent? Like I say, they're down to the last two Pokemon. They do have access to Fake Out now, so it's probably what they're going to go for into the Regieleki. I'm going to take this turn to actually Max Guard with Metagross just to stall out this last turn of Trick Room, and then hope that Regieleki goes down here. Even if not, the next turn, if it's still around, we've still got a good opportunity to knock out the Glastrier and also the Incineroar with a combination from our two Pokemon. If Regieleki goes down here, then Urshifu can come in and do the same job. We do see a Max Quake from the Glastrier. It is going to be into the Regieleki and be more than enough to pick up the knockout there, getting another Chilling Nair boost to its attack stat, and we see it is actually Life Orb, so we didn't need to worry too much about the weakness policy, but the Life Orb's still a big item on it, which you should have noticed a little bit earlier. Flare Blitz coming out from the Incineroar, but just into that Max Guard as the Trick Room turns do end, and it is time for us to bring Urshifu onto the field, and between Urshifu and Metagross, we are going to be able to close this one up pretty quickly. We've got the Iron Head we're going to go for into the Glastrier, and just a close combat into the Incineroar. Now, not intimidated with the Choice Band, we're going to have more than enough to pick up the knockout onto the Incineroar, and plus two attack Metagross, it definitely had speed in the Glastrier, is going to be able to pick up the knockout there. Now, we do see the Glastrier protect from my opponent, but the close combat going to be more than enough to take down the Incineroar, and that all but closes the game up for us as we go into the final turn, and my opponent just goes for a battle cancellation, and we do pick up the win. So that is two wins for the team and two different archetypes that we've played here, and I feel like it's kind of proved a point that you can take the top six Pokemon from the usage stats and just plonk them in a team and use them and have some success. So I hope you've enjoyed today's episode. It has been a lot of fun doing today's episode. It was just an idea I've had for a long time, where I always look and analyze the usage stats and always wonder to myself, can I take these top six Pokemon and just dump them in a team, and will it work? And I think we've had a lot of fun in today's video. It is a bit of fun obviously doing this, but at the same time, I think it goes a long way into showing if you want to jump into competitive Pokemon, there are quick ways for you to do this, and the usage stats do not lie. We've got very powerful Pokemon and they make up a very strong team. So hope you've enjoyed today's episode, friends. If you have, do consider subscribing to the channel. I would be very appreciative of any subs that we do get. We are on the road to 13,000 subs at the minute, which is insane, so hopefully we can get there soon. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I will catch you all for another episode in the coming days.